Joining us on Hot Copy this morning, we have Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel. Senator Pimentel, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen, and to all of our viewers. Magandang umaga po sa lahat.
You are calling on President Marcos Jr. to veto the Maharlika Investment Fund bill, but we know it's a bill that he himself certified as urgent. Frankly speaking, are you hopeful that he is going to veto the bill?
Karen, when a bill is certified, there was already an existing version. And sometimes after this bill goes through the so-called legislative mill, it changes its look, its contents. And I believe that the product, the latest version or iteration of this Maharlika bill is not the one originally desired by the president. Kasi what the majority in the Senate did was they disqualified not less than 6 funds from participating in the capital and in the capital of the corporation, as well as from participating in the fund itself, the Maharlika Investment Fund. And then in the original version of the bill coming from the House of Representatives, there were exemptions. Tax exemptions from laws, which are safeguard laws or regulations. So the corporation was expected to be exempted. Tinanggal din po yun. So this is a very different version from the one certified as urgent. Hence, that the president can use that as the reason for he's vetoing the bill, and at the same time, kaming mga against, we will also appreciate such an act because one of our objections is that this is being rushed and the people, not only legislators, Karen, but the people, because the people must be involved, are not given sufficient time to understand and to discuss what this is all about. So vetoing the measure will give us the time that we're asking for.
So, Senator, essentially what you're saying is you want the president to veto the bill for his own reasons, not yes. necessarily yours, all right?
Yes.
For his
yes.
own interests in the bill. But you voted no for the Maharlika Investment Fund bill. Are you saying that if it changes, yes. there's even a possibility you could agree to it?
No, because I'm against the philosophy, the reason or the justification behind the bill. But as I've stated earlier, one of our objections is the lack of consultation.
Mm.
So not only to a consultation with congressmen or lawmakers, but the people must be consulted. So at least that objection is being addressed. So you know, and then during that consultation or a series of meetings all over the country, they should invite those against so that we can also, you know, we can also elaborate or expound on the reasons why we are against.
Okay. Now, the new version of the Maharlika Investment Fund bill has changed. Its face, it's not the original proposed bill anymore. So let's discuss some of the big changes in the bill. Number one is there's no more seed money coming from pension funds. No more money coming from the SSS, GSIS. Does that make you feel any more hopeful about the bill?
No, because there's still no surplus. Originally, this was called the Sovereign Wealth Fund. That was the original plan. So we assume that that is the idea also in the mind of the president. And then all of a sudden, it made a left turn, Karen. It's now an investment fund. It's no longer a sovereign wealth fund, an investment fund where private individuals and institutions, syempre yung mga mayayaman, can participate. And then not only Filipinos, plus foreigners. So it's really too far from a sovereign fund, because that's no longer the sovereign Filipino people's fund. Meron na, foreigners can already participate. Okay, so yun. And then the original plan, if the original plan was a sovereign wealth fund, this is basically a fund generated by surplus. Oh, there are two sources of this possible surplus. Number one is there's a budget surplus. We are collecting more taxes and non-tax revenues than we are spending. Eh, hindi totoo sa Pilipinas yun. Budget deficit tayo. And there could also be trade surplus, meaning to say we are exporting, benta sa mundo, more than we are importing. It trade deficit din tayo, Karen, mga kababayan. Ang trade in goods deficit nga natin hindi bumababa ng $40 billion a year. Oh, dollars na yung billion pa. Oh, so and then sometimes in some countries they have a lucky discovery of a precious commodity or a natural resource like oil. Oh, so meron silang all of a sudden they have a windfall profit or a cash flow. Oh, so this is what happened to Norway. Eh, wala naman din nangyari sa atin ganyan. So if we want to establish a fund, this should be the reasons why they all of a sudden we want to establish a fund, not because we want to get money which are already existing and these are amounts which are already under the jurisdiction of boards of funds of institutions. So ginugulo pa natin yung mga board nila, eh. In charge na po sila sa fund na yon, eh. Kukunin natin and then we will give it to a new board. And then the original instruction pa, Karen, the original concept was that this new board, this Maharlika Investment Fund, will optimize or maximize the return of their investments. Meaning to say, they are not, this new board is now allowed to place the money, the existing money that they got from some entity, they are now allowed to place this in riskier investments. Sugal.
Senator.
Isugal ng konti.
Okay. So let me just, I was listening to you right there. I spoke with Senator Sherwin Gatchalian and others who voted for the fund. And the Sovereign Wealth Fund has, in other words, you're talking about the original plan, and clearly it has changed. It's been tweaked. It's now an investment fund, where in other countries they claim do it too. And I believe it's either Laos or Bangladesh, a country that's lower in terms of GDP than the Philippines, but they are developing their own fund. All right. So first is, they believe that with the Maharlika Investment Fund, I wanted to ask you this, is the fund could have a return of 8.64% on equity every year. Senator Mark Villar said this because the fund will develop into two sub-funds, the Capital Market Investment Fund and a Sectoral Investment Sub-Fund. In other words, with this kind of program, it's an 8.65 earning a year, which I would have to say, if that's guaranteed, is bigger than what we're currently getting. I mean, you do have government securities at 5.5 or around that benchmark. So what the fund is no longer sovereign. Let's not call it that anymore. But the fund is meant to invest so that it could either give better services to people, develop human capital and infrastructure. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, that projection of 8+% return.
8.6.
8.6. Sabi ko nga, that's a very brave and positive projection, but that still remains a projection. And the world economy is in bad shape, Karen. Even the manager of the Norwegian Sovereign Wealth Fund, yun yung gold standard ngayon eh, said that for in the next 10 years, it is very, very difficult to generate returns. Okay. So there is pessimism from the gold standard of investment funds, the Norwegian sovereign wealth funds. But coming from dito naman sa mga proponents of the Maharlika Wealth Fund, 8.6%. Sabi nila, pero still the projection. But next question, what is that? A real return? If it's a real return, you have to add the inflation plus the 2% cost kaagad, automatic cost of administrative and operating expenses. So imagine ko, let's assume inflation is at 5%, plus 2% yung gastos nila, 7. I-add mo ngayon yun dun sa ano. So 15 plus percent return ang ginagarantee nila to achieve that real return of 8%. But the point is ganito, Karen. That original 8% plus projection was already made even before the announcement that there will be two sub-funds. Tandaan mo. So yung 8% originally, ano yun, aggressive investment yun. Yun yung nakasulat pa rin dito, generate optimal returns on investments. Yan yan. That's still the instruction eh. But then by creating a sub-fund for the developmental projects, ito yung mga developmental projects na sinasabi nila na spend on the projects even though the return is not guaranteed, is not clear, even though there is no return. All the more, 8% na yan noon eh, when it was still totally aggressive fund eh. Ngayon, they will now do two sub-funds. How come they changed now the strategy? They accommodated the developmental funds na you are not after returns, and then they will now retain their original projection as if it will not be affected. So that is the question. At saka, this is, ulitin ko po, that's a projection based actually, Karen, on the original version, kung tutuusin. So, the original version has changed a lot. Therefore, do not tell me the original projection has not been affected by the changes. Imposible po yun.
Okay, because the Bureau of Treasury actually proposed a return on equity from a range of 6.5% to even 10.7%, depending on what they said was the blend of the placements. So the bigger question really is the fund meant to invest on equities, emerging market equities, or is it meant to invest in infrastructure, develop human capital? There seems to be a confusion on what is the fund for? What are we doing the fund?
Correct. That confusion still exists in the final version. Andun yun, it's in that controversial section 14, allowable investments. The fund can do anything and everything, especially naglista pa yun ng A to J, and then meron pang last paragraph doon na sinabi na anything that the board wants to invest in, they can invest in. And then if you look at the allowable investments, Karen, iba-ibang expertise po yun ang kailangan. In the private sector, there are funds just dedicated to one of those allowable investments. Ngayon tayo, we are putting up a government corporation which we now claim to be super talented, super genius government corporation that they can invest in varied investments with different expertise requirements. Ano example? Pwede daw pumunta sa metals. So metals trading po ang tawag dyan. Other tradable commodities. Iba naman siguro to, mga futures ito of corn, wheat, ganon. So ibang expertise po yun. Papasok din ng real estate. Papasok pa sa joint venture. Also, how much will we spend in hiring the different kinds of experts and their support staff so that we will be able to successfully generate returns in a very difficult world economic situation?
Okay. Is it clear in the bill? I'm curious. It seems that the list of where they can invest, right, is it's expansive. Is it clear where the profit is meant to be spent? So let's say kumita po ang fund. Nakasaad po ba sa bill, the fund will be spent here? Because who benefits from the fund? If the fund earns, how does that benefit the Filipino people directly? Does it state there?
Hey, I think it's part of the investment principles, Karen, to also invest what you earn. So hindi talaga mararamdaman ito. And then the fund followed the corporation code concept, di ba? Merong authorized capital stock and there are stockholders. Therefore, if there is, let us say, earnings or profits and they want to declare dividends, they will follow the corporation code that the dividends will go to the stockholders.
Yeah, but who are the stockholders? Like for example, the GSIS. The GSIS invests in the hope that in the future, these investments, wise investments they've made, benefit the GSIS members, right? That's the science. The SSS invests in the hope that when SSS members need a loan, they need a bigger pension, the SSS can provide that, and the investments are supposed to help. So does it state in the bill who benefits from the profits of Maharlika? It can't be members of the board.
Wala doon, but we will follow, that's why we will follow the corporation code principles, because this version tried to follow the corporation code. So definitely, if there are earnings and the board now decides to declare dividends, they will now go to the stockholders. Who are the stockholders? Land Bank of the Philippines, BBP. Development Bank of the Philippines, the national government. So this will now, so yung whatever is the part of the national government will now go to the general fund. Dadaan ngayon through budget yon. Whatever the land bank receives will not go directly to the people. This will form part of the so-called investable funds of the land bank kasi earnings niya ito. And then si DBP. Yes. So ganun po yon. And then hindi pa natin binabanggit yung private participants, because in the future there could be private participants. So they will also get their dividends. Diba? Private, so Filipinos plus foreigners.
Yeah. So that's one question right there, right? Is how does this benefit the Filipino people directly? Okay, number two, one would say that they will be spent for big ticket items that will spur the economy. Senator Aimee Marcos asked good questions, but she still voted for the fund. She said, what is the added value of the fund, considering that you have agencies already committed and committed to doing certain big ticket projects, and we have also PPP.
Correct. That's correct. And then plus this latest concept introduced in the final version, which is the other projects which are more or less socio or developmental projects. So hindi ito, not necessarily earning projects, kasama yon eh. And then the proponents talk about the fund spending on big ticket mega infrastructure projects. Imagine mo, Karen, it will be a 9-member unelected board which will now decide on the mega infrastructure projects. Right now, if there is a big project, it will pass through Congress, at least the people's representatives, and you and the people will know who to blame. Diba? And our processes are transparent, covered by the media. We have a journal, and then we publish the GAA. We are live stream. Iba po. We are really actually. This is really, as I stated in my contra speech, this is really a slap on the face of the budget process of Congress.
Okay. Senator, and to our viewers, I'd like to make a correction just to be absolutely factual. So Senator Aimee Marcos was absent during voting.
She did not vote, yes.
Yeah, so technically she did not vote yes. So I apologize for that. Yeah. So I'm being very technical about this because some abstained. And you, sir, you didn't make it to the voting, but you registered a no.
Yes, because I was also the only one who delivered a contra speech, Karen. That means I stated for the record my position.
Okay. All right. Another tweak in the bill right now is the Banco Central ng Pilipinas dividend contribution was tweaked. So I believe in the present bill you're holding is the BSP will now contribute 100% of its remittances during the first and second year of the Maharlika Fund's establishment. That's a maximum of up to 50 billion. And the whole idea is to allow the BSP to use more of its dividends for the capital buildup. Is there any project? Will there be a loss somewhere with the BSP now committed to contributing 100% of its remittances to the Maharlika Fund?
Well, the same. The thing affected would be the increase in the capitalization of the BSP.
Okay. And how does that matter to the economy, the Filipino people, if the capitalization of the BSP is lessened?
Yeah. The capitalization of the BSP has been increased, and then the national government will contribute to the said amount, and there was already a timetable fixed in existing law, but that timetable will now change because there will be a delay of 2 years, at least 2 years, in the contribution. So what is the capitalization of the BSP for? Ito, this is its ammunition po ito ng BSP to fight the attacks on Philippine peso, so that the BSP can protect the value of the Philippine peso against foreign currencies. This is the ammunition of the BSP in helping our banks, because the BSP is the bank of last resort. And then this can also be used to for price stability, yung inflation mandate din po yan ng BSP. So yun po ang dahilan, that's the reason why we are giving the BSP sufficient capital, supposed to be. Yun eh.
Because but do you think there will be a dramatic effect in terms of the capitalization of the BSP? I mean, it's 50 billion. One would say 50 billion isn't a lot for the BSP.
Correct, because they said that the economy has already grown. Yeah. So we had the capitalization of that bank of last resort, that bank which also fights inflation and then ensures the value of the Philippine peso, or should have sufficient ammunition. Siguro, if there will be no shocks or emergencies or unforeseen circumstances, then the BSP can have can follow its plan, its normal plan. So kaya nila i-manage. But yun na nga, we should fear if there is now all of a sudden an unforeseen circumstance event. Or event. Yeah. Uh-oh. So okay. Yun na. So ano, saan huhugot ngayon si BSP ng mga ammunition niya to fulfill its basic three mandates.
Uh-oh. Senator Professor Edna Ko, the Dean of the UP Public Administration, has a good question here for you. What do you think is the effect on the regular bureaucracy functions of a special body that would decide on the utilization of the Maharlika funds? I understand this special body under Maharlika might cover or overlap with the regular bureaucracy's mandate and fund utilization. Could it?
Especially now when it is no longer really a maximization of ROI. pwede na siyang pumasok sa developmental projects in which fields there may be already GOCCs acting in that field or the regular departments. Ganun ngayon, especially siguro what was inserted was parang sa health eh. Health. Yeah. So maybe the DOH or education will be affected. Plus the budget process will be affected because there will ulit ko sinabi ko kanina Karen, there's now a 9-man unelected board which will be deciding on the fate or the implementation of big ticket mega infrastructure projects. Yung plano nila. Sabi ko nga, the landscape of the Philippines will change and the representatives of the people are not even participating in the decision making process. Imagine mo, binabanggit nila bridge from Bataan to Cavite. Across the bay yun. So magbabago yung...
But wouldn't that be part of the Philippine Development Plan? I mean, so Professor Solita Monsod said one should look at the Philippine Development Plan. That bridge, I would assume, should be there.
Hindi, wala. It's not that detailed na naka-pinpoint ko yun. That should be in the budget.
Under the DPWH po ba yun, pag ganun?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
So that is what is happening. So
yeah.
Medyo, that means that the proponents themselves are also not happy with the budget process. But ganito, this is my point eh. The president has so much political capital and so much support from Congress that he can request overwhelming number of votes from both houses to create the Maharlika. Then use that same political capital and political influence for the bridge, for the dam, for the roads that you want to build.
Yeah. No, now that I'm listening to you, Senator Pimentel, coming also from Senator Aimee's earlier questions and hearing from Professor Monsod, would it have been more practical? I mean, I do hope that somehow the president asks this too at some point, is if the fund was more specific, for example, we build processing for mining, so we don't already export raw material, right? So then it would change how we profit from our own minerals. Or let's say we only fund green projects. So then hopefully it can contribute to the price of electricity going down. I mean, something so specific that it would change the landscape that the agencies aren't doing. Pwede pa ba yon?
Well, ako kasi, Karen, I'm really basically against the philosophy or the justification behind the proposal because there is no justification because there's no surplus, no windfall profit.
Yeah. But it's there.
Yung binanggit mo can be done in the national budget. Because it's a matter of the president expressing his plan, his will, and then let his supporters, his overwhelming number of supporters, follow him and execute it in the national budget.
So, Senator, like mining, for example, I don't understand why the Philippines is very rich in minerals. We're still exporting raw material. Right. It's processed in other countries in ASEAN. Why don't we spend to process our own raw materials so the mining industry and the Philippines could earn more from revenue from that? Like yon, if sabi po ninyo pwede sa budget yon, bakit wala po yun sa budget? Baka pwedeng yun na lang ang Maharlika.
Correct. Kaya nga, sabi ko nga, I completely agree with you, Karen. No? Sinabi ko nga, that's yung present setup natin ngayon. It's actually what the colonizers did to their colonies. Source of raw materials lang. Eh. Ang ngayon yung sinasabi nyo is value added.
So there's value. That's what I was thinking.
Value
added to spending the fund.
there will be value-added activity here in the Philippines so that what we export will be more precious or more valuable than the raw material, the ore. So I completely agree with you. Pero, you know, kung yan ang nasa isip ng presidente at explain niya sa mga mambabatas yan, kung kaya niyang kumuha ng overwhelming support for this Maharlika na hindi natin alam saan pupunta, ano yung decision making, the all the more he will get support. But then ito kasi yung mangyayari yan eh. Yung mga value-added activities, we can leave that to the private sector, but we can give incentives for them to do that. The ENR will probably have to come up with updated regulations, diba, to govern the export of ore material. Ganon. And then the country will profit from the, syempre, income tax, the other, the excise taxes, the other permits and licenses and non-tax revenues that we can impose on the industry. But pwedeng mas klaro yan because there will now be a specific, maybe there will be a specific law governing that industry. Unlike ito, a Maharlika fund, tapos yan pala ang gusto mo, yan ang gustong gawin, for example, ang layo eh. What did we create? We created an investment fund and yet that is what we want to achieve. Dapat very specific po tayo.
Moving just to close the Maharlika Investment Fund bill. So we've seen the changes in the new version. You've called on the president to veto. I understand that either he accepts this in full, or if there's something he doesn't agree with, he has to return it back to Congress in full as well, right? Because it isn't a revenue or appropriation measure.
All or nothing. All or nothing.
It's on, all or nothing. Yeah, well said. It's all or nothing. So if he does not veto, what is the next option for you, Senator? What should we look out for?
For those who have doubts or for those who are against the entire idea, and of course, there have been, in my opinion, also some constitutional issues along the way. So we can challenge the constitutionality of this bill in before the Supreme Court. So the approach would be the presidential certification did not follow the constitutional requirement that there should be a public calamity or emergency right before our faces, which the bill will answer. Diba? So wala naman eh, because this bill, the benefits of this bill, if any, would be siguro 5 years from now. So that definitely does not answer an emergency. And then the internal or inherent confusion within the bill, Karen, that is, in my opinion, that amounts to violation of substantive due process. Kasi hindi natin maintindihan ano ba talaga ang role nitong bill na ito. Kumita o hindi kumita sa sovereign wealth fund o hindi sovereign wealth fund, kasi the bill still mentions the Santiago principles, Karen. The Santiago principles are for sovereign wealth fund. So it's either admit that you are a sovereign wealth fund, do not pretend that you are a sovereign wealth fund, or just you are a mere investment fund. So don't mention the Santiago principles, which are for sovereign wealth funds. So mga ganon. So we can use the inherent confusion, internal inconsistency, as a ground for substantive due process challenge, Karen.
Yeah. So you mean to say it's still stated inside the bill?
Yes. Santiago principles. Nandito. Yes, it's here.
Okay. All right. Because I think, we have yet to get a copy of the exact bill. But I'm reading.
We need to look at that exact bill because since the House merely adopted the Senate version, there should be no change whatsoever in the Senate third and final reading version. Not a single word, di ba, should be changed. So that's why we have to look at the final version also.
Okay. Now, as Congress goes on recess, both houses have only finished 6 out of 42 LEDAC priorities that was given out by President Marcos Jr. in the first year. coming from the prioritization of the Maharlika Investment Fund, and only 6 out of 42 LEDAC priorities were passed. What do you make of that, Senator?
Well, maybe 42 is also too ambitious, Karen. So I think they have a priority 1 and a priority 2 lists. So, but yeah, when we come back, I think we will be tackling now the salt industry. Yung sasin. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Para sa akin, importante yun. Mas importante pa sana yun dito sa Maharlika. So, yun na sana ang pagpuyata namin, hindi ito. So, yun po. And then, but to the credit of Congress, we have also passed some very important laws, Karen. Yeah. Like yung AFP, AFP retirement, yan, inayos na. Yes. It took a lot of time, but that's a law worthy of devoting to much time and much energy. Mm-hmm. And then of course yung may maraming panawagan taong bayan natin to extend this estate tax amnesty period. Yan, binigay po na. And then merong idea si Senator Joel Villanueva of there should be a employment generation master plan. Ano pala yun eh? That's a commitment. That's also an international commitment based on a treaty we have entered into. So we have also passed that. So marami-rami na rin. Siguro yung the 6 you mentioned, Karen, I think are those already signed as law, signed into law. But there are many more third reading measures already passed, Karen.
Okay. Now, just very quickly, I know, given the fact that it's only you and Senator Riza Ontiveros in the minority and in the opposition in the Senate, there were talks at some point that there was pressure to pass the Maharlika because of an alleged coup against Senator Mig Zubiri. What is your take on that? Professor Solita Monsod said it seems that the rush passage, she says, in the Senate was more of a political move than an economic move.
Definitely, this is not an economic move kasi I doubt the benefits we can get from the Maharlika, yung 8%. Plus, that's just a projection. But then going to that alleged coup, I did not feel any action on the ground.
On the ground,
yes, nothing. The Senate President is secure in his leadership of the Senate. Okay. But it's not. No, but we were against it because there is really no surplus. No,
yes. You were against it on issues.
No, yeah, justification.
But hearing from you that you yourself are saying Senate President Mig Zubiri is secure in his position, and considering the history you've both had, so that's quite objective. Yes, coming from your end, he's secure in his position.
That All right. Very objective.
Yeah. All right. Now, you've also called on, I believe a few weeks back, you've called on an investigation on the long-delayed issuance of the national ID cards. I did get a laminated card. I believe that was my national ID. But how delayed are we?
I have gotten complaints or feedback, Karen, even from my own staff and then from friends. You know, some are anong tawag doon, positive anong feedback naman. They got their IDs quickly. Yung iba naman, 2 years na, wala pa. And then there's even this strange complaint or feedback that he or she was given a file and then he or she would be the one to print out the ID.
Really?
So, yes.
That is wrong. Yeah.
Merong ganun, you print your own ID. So sabi ko, what's wrong? So sabi ko, I think we really have to conduct a hearing on the national ID. What difficulties are they facing? And then I think I want to look at the budget also, Karen. I think the final budget for this would be more than 20 billion pesos. Eh. So,
Yeah, but
tatanungin
haven't
natin,
they
how come
released?
it has bloated to such an amount?
No, but has the 20 billion pesos been released and
Di pa,
spent
multi-year.
already?
Multi-year. That's why at the end of the entire project, how much would be spent? Ang tinanong ko yan, eh. I think ang sagot
Uh-oh.
Sa akin, it was an amount more than 20 billion. Eh.
Uh-oh. Now, but would the national ID, if released, because now you filed the Senate bill based on the issues, it's unreasonably prolonged delivery, but you said something about questionable usefulness. I wanted to ask you, because
yes. Oh,
I filled in a visa application recently, and they did ask for a national ID number. So won't that
they
be
asked,
useful?
They asked for it. They asked for it.
Yes.
Oh, good, very good.
Uh-oh.
That's a
so
positive.
Please, that's
a
one.
Positive feedback. But
yeah.
I've got some negative feedback that even some institutions, and including banks, will not accept it because there is no signature.
Oh, that's so odd. So it is confusing, because ideally you're right. A bank should accept it if you're applying for a loan or you're opening an account or anything. Yeah.
But the reason given was that the ID does not show or does not bear any signature. So
yeah.
So it must be a weakness in the design or the overall planning of the ID. So pag-usapan natin yun, kasi siguro ang sagot sa atin dyan, then the bank should scan the QR code, or I think that is the so I hope the hearing will bring out all of these issues so that the answers will come out, and then
yeah.
we can also take a look at the budget, the overall budget.
Okay, and another thing you also filed in your Senate bill is to investigate the supposed substandard quality of the national ID. I wish I brought it here, because it would be good to actually show our viewers. What I received was laminated, a simple laminated in plastic. So it seems it's paper inside or some cardboard, and it's laminated. And yet I have a PhilHealth ID, which is really, it's hard. So I wanted to ask you, what should it be? Because it, like a credit card, for example, is a hard plastic. Was that what a national ID should be?
When we were discussing it, that was
exactly,
what was in
yeah.
my mind. And pero
yeah.
you better ask your staff, Karen. Maybe they were the ones who had that laminated. You ask
really?
Them.
Okay.
You ask them.
Okay. Yeah. Because it was delivered, but that's a good point. So you're right. That national ID should not be laminated. It's temporary.
I mean,
it's still temporary.
That's the problem, Karen, because some of those who applied got a file.
Yeah.
File, oh, digital oh. file. And then the instruction is print it. So print
yeah.
it, so most likely.
That could be ours. I don't know. I will check.
The normal printer would be paper, di ba?
Paper. And then you
the
laminate
material
it.
Is paper. The PSA did not assume that you have a printer for plastic cards. You have
yeah.
a printer yeah. which will print on paper. So
yeah.
that's it. So we will have to ask all of these questions para po maklaruhan tayo. And then siguro to put some guidance na rin, to
yeah.
give guidance to the implementer.
But I think this is important simply because we paid for it already. We budgeted it, and it's been 2 years, you're saying, Senator, we have not seen the actual national ID, which should be hard plastic, like a credit card.
That was what I expected.
Uh-oh.
Pero yun na, ulitin ko, some are getting files. So therefore, from the point of view of the implementer, that is not the plan, di ba? Because
yeah.
they can give files.
Yeah. Okay. So before we close, so wait, when are you starting this hearing? Do you have a schedule that would be interesting?
I think it's with Senator Francis Tolentino.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
I will allow him to know. Of course, as a chairman, we defer
yes.
to the schedule of the chairman.
Okay. All right. Before we go, we don't have enough time, but from the time I interviewed you first on Head Start, you said there's no loss for the president to actually appoint an agriculture secretary. It would be an additional In effect, it would help him. It would be an additional person. The president is busy, he travels, he's fixing other problems in the country. Mm. Well, he is going to give his State of the Nation on the first year in a month or two. And yet there is still no agriculture secretary. He still is concurrent. What are your thoughts, Senator?
Yes, and look at the consequence.
Yeah.
If he really gives the real State of the Nation, then he cannot avoid mentioning all of these issues concerning to agriculture or food. Sibuyas, onion, yung mga pork, chicken, mga presyo nito. Sugar, lalo na yung sugar. Ilang fiascos na, dalawa na kaagad. Dalawa na kaagad this early into the administration. So, yan. That would, if the president will really give us the real State of the Nation, he will not be able to avoid discussing, mentioning, or talking about agricultural issues or food-related issues na hindi nasosolve. Kasi pati inflation, if you talk about inflation, food cost din yan eh. Energy, of course, plus food. So, basically, so that's it. That is the consequence.
All right. So, on that note, I want to thank you so much, Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, for joining me today, sir. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you for inviting me. Thank you
very much. Now, much appreciated and insightful and thorough discussion on several issues. Thank you, sir.